Good afternoon. This is the latest IRIS facilitated webinar. This one has an Earthscope US Array focus. This is Andy Forsetto broadcasting to you from the Incorporated Research Institutions for Seismology headquarters office in Washington, D.C. So, just for introductions, if you're not familiar, IRIS is a nearly 30-year-old consortium of universities, and it's a science facility that's funded by NSF to operate programs that enable the earth science community, especially seismologists, perform a broad spectrum of geophysical research. If you don't know me personally, I'm the project associate, aka Swiss Army Knife, who helps to manage some of IRIS's instrumentation-related programs, as well as community engagement activities such as this. And specifically, these webinars are designed to highlight a lot of the scientific results that are either directly enabled by IRIS or represent important work from some of our partner organizations. What I have up on the screen here is our webinar homepage. And so these are a list of previously broadcast webinars that have been archived through YouTube. So if you click on one of these thumbnails, it will take you to a YouTube page where you can watch these webinars, make comments, and in general, catch up on some of the previous topics that have been posted. And so this webinar, when it's done, is going to end up archived on this webpage as well. So I think without further ado, I would like to introduce our speaker today. It's Dr. Rob Porritt. He's a National Science Foundation postdoctoral researcher at the University of Southern California. He's doing his postdoc with Megan Miller. In 2013, Rob received his PhD from the University of California, Berkeley, working primarily on problems related to structural seismology and seismic imaging in the Western U.S. In addition to his research that you'll be hearing about today, Rob has been an active member in the IRIS community, and he's worked with our education and public outreach program as a formal mentor to our IRIS summer interns from 2009 to 2011. And he's also served as an instructor for last year's US Array short course. I've known Rob since I had the pleasure of mentoring him myself when he was an IRIS intern all the way back in 2006. So, without further ado, I'd like to introduce Rob to present on the Western U.S. Lithosphere Blues.
So thank you, Andy, and thank you everyone for attending. Thanks, Andy, also for giving me the chance to speak to you today, as well as organizing this webinar series. I'm also a long-term viewer and very happy to be able to present this work. So I want to start by thanking a lot of the various colleagues who have helped me with a lot of this work, particularly my PhD advisor, Richard Allen at UC Berkeley, as well as his regional imaging group. So I want to thank my postdoc advisor, Megan Miller, and our group here at USC, as well as collaborators at USGS and various people helping us on this fieldwork experiment. So much of what I did early was some fieldwork experiments, the FACES experiment and the Mendocino experiment in Northern California and Oregon, and that work has also helped me kind of think through some of these questions I'm going to be presenting today. So it's important to note that a lot of this is work in progress, so please feel free to comment. If you're watching live, you have, as Andy mentioned, your box up above. But if you're watching it later on YouTube, there's always the comments down below. So I'd love to get some feedback and think a bit more about what I'm presenting today, what we can say more about it. So please feel free to comment. So for those who maybe not are used to the U.S., I know this is international, so there's hopefully some people abroad. Here's our topographic map of the U.S., very strong dichotomy between the eastern U.S., which is largely flat, and the western U.S. As I said, this is the western U.S., so I'm basically going to cut a line here through the Rocky Mountain front. And the western U.S. is a really great place to do geology for several reasons. Not to say that the eastern U.S. isn't great as well. I'm originally from Michigan myself, so I have a spot in my heart for the eastern U.S. too. But the high topography makes it kind of interesting that we have high topography so far away from an active plate boundary zone. There's low vegetation, so you can actually see the rocks, which is always very useful for geology. And there's very low population density throughout much of this area, so it's great if you're kind of a loner and you just want to get out and look at some rocks. So for a lot of this talk, at least the jumping off point of this talk, is going to be using seismic tomography. So I want to give a brief primer, which I found on the IRIS Education and Outreach website, which I think is a really useful way to illustrate the strengths of seismic tomography. So in, up here in this image, we have two seismic recorders, and we are recording a bunch of waves from earthquakes. And as these rays from the earthquake, these seismic waves pass through a relatively 1D structure, let's say this purely yellow line, it just arrives when we expect it would. But if we have this other seismic ray going through maybe some fast velocity material, some high velocity material, it's going to arrive a little bit early. And so we're going to see that this sensor here has a relatively early arrival, whereas the other sensor has what we expect. But we can't really tell much more than that. We have relatively limited. But as we add more sensors, we can start to see that maybe there's more of this anomaly off to the right, a little off, less off to the left. And as we add yet still further sensors, we can start to build up a clearer, more and more clear picture of what's going on in the subsurface. And I also want to point out that you'll notice above where these rays cross, we still have red. So for these five sensors, we still see some anomaly, but we, because we don't have any crossing ray information, when we use waves that or rays that travel through this type geometry, we really lose that information where the rays don't cross. So typically when we look at, say, a body wave tomography model, the upper maybe 60 kilometers is usually not very well resolved. So some simple pros and cons of travel time tomography, which is, as I said, my kind of main tool. It's a reliable, robust input data. So when you make these measurements, you're going to be measuring the travel time of a P wave, which is a very easy measurement to make. It's very reliable, very repeatable. And what we usually get from these methodologies is simply the shape and size of mantle anomalies. And also, we usually are able to get good spatial resolution based on the station spacing. With a body wave case, because our rays are vertical, we have very good lateral east-west and north-south resolution. But we don't always have the best vertical resolution. But there is also some cons to the method. Because we're looking at relative arrival times, we lose the absolute velocity information. Now, this is something that there's been a lot of work done to try and get around or try and figure out that absolute information. And I think it's an important direction for body wave tomography to go. One of the problems is that, another problem is that we can see several features, but they often appear blob-like, and they're sensitive to the ray paths. And that's going to be a bit harder to get around, but if we get more data, or maybe better inverse theories, or more data types, we can start to address that problem. Finally, because the amplitude of these anomalies are constrained by regularization, we can't always say the actual amplitude of the anomaly. So one model may have a 2% fast, another model may have 1% fast, but that may just be a function of the damping imposed in the final solution. So because this is also a supposed to be for people who are from all walks of life, I want to give a seismic tomography color 101. So for those who've never looked at a seismic tomography model or wonder what all the reds and blues are, well, on the left, I've shown what we observe. If we observe a high velocity or high wave speed, we'll typically color it blue, which will usually imply a low temperature, which implies a low density for the rocks. And the reverse is true, that we, if we see a low velocity, we're going to have color red for high temperature and low density. And also in the middle, where there's kind of no, where we're near zero, some people will color green, some white. I typically will go with white or not any. So keep that in mind when you see the tomography images. So I want to start with our first tomography image from this SEMA model at 200 kilometers. This is an image from data that I pulled from the IRIS Earth Model Collaboration Suite, which is a very useful tool that IRIS is making available to compare and contrast several different models in a very kind of uniform view. What's nice about this particular model is that it's a global model. It's not quite travel time. They're actually going further and using waveform fits to get closer to the data. It does have its pros and cons, though, as well. This particular model is on a 2-degree by 2-degree global grid, so I'm just extracting a small portion, and you can see the short wave, well, the very long wavelength structure of the U.S. Particularly, we note the Laurentia Craton in the center of the continent, and the Cordillera, which is where we see that high topography that I talked about earlier. It's very low velocity, so even on kind of a global scale, this is slightly low velocity, so generally we think these rocks are somewhat warm. There's also some features that strike me as such as the Great Meteor Hotspot. This is maybe a bigger anomaly than what we normally think of the region. And also, don't tell anybody in Texas, but Texas also kind of stands out a little bit as its own kind of weird little microcontinent in some of these models. So for those who may be not familiar enough with AirScope yet, this is just a map I pulled from the Array Network facility back in September of last year. And this shows basically entire U.S., entire continuous U.S., blanketed with seismic stations, as well as a number of transportable array stations up in Quebec and Ontario. So we basically have extremely good coverage, and basically covering the entire U.S., and actually this map is incomplete as far as the coverage available in the U.S. So I'm going to talk a little bit now about how we actually construct this model. And if you want to go and learn more information about the model or download it yourself, you can go to this easy-to-remember website that the biologists at Berkeley hate. And basically what we're doing is we measured these relative travel times and used their finite frequency kernels to get their sensitivity through the mantle. And we measure these body waves in a ray-centric coordinate frame so that we're able to get independent estimates of the P arrival, the SV component S arrival, and the SH component S arrival. And for an example of the actual data coverage for stations that we have in this model, this is just the P model, and each one of these inverted triangles is one station. I've color-coded by that P station correction, which I talked about is basically where those rays don't cross, how much time would it take to get through. So we see some instant, these are solved for in the final inversion, so we instantly see some really interesting structure, particularly with the Laurentia Craton here with these very, very negative delays, so that means they arrived quite a bit earlier than we expected, versus the western U.S., which are these very late delays, so in general the rays arrive later than we'd expect. Also showing our event corrections to try and convince you that we do have very good event distribution, and this gives us our azimuth and incidence of the rays. Basically, I've used the iris fetch data script to get all events with at least three stations at between 30 and 80 degrees recording. So basically, this is the best coverage that we can really do with about 5 years worth of data. Now, if you go to the dna.berkeley.edu website, you'll also see our SV component model, which I'm not going to talk too much about, but it also incorporates, in a joint inversion, teleseismic surface wave phase velocities to constrain the lithosphere, as well as ambient noise-derived phase velocities to kind of constrain the crust. Now, the lithosphere, the teleseismic phase velocity, to look at the lithosphere, we have down to about 125 seconds period, and for the crust, we're at much shorter wavelengths or shorter periods from the ambient noise. So if you're not familiar with Whitmire and Karlstrom, I like to refer to it as the Precambrian North American Bible. It's really a really robust kind of view of North America and how it grew from a series of protocontinents that formed the core of Laurentia here, and then a series of accretionary events which grew the U.S. from the southeast, resulting in this kind of northeast to southwest grain. And what's really going to interest us in the western U.S. focus is this strontium line. So basically this red line through here represents the line between old and young lithosphere. So keep this line in mind. We'll come back to it in a little bit. Basically most of this stuff in kind of Washington, California, Nevada, we can consider to be relatively young, or at least post-Cambrian, if you will. Cenozoic, I guess. So I want to take some look at the model. This is the DNA 13-P model. So here's a couple maps, one at 200 kilometers and 500 kilometers, and the associated cross-sections that go through here. So if you remember this 200-kilometer depth slice is quite a bit different than what we looked at earlier in VED's model, in the Senlon model. But we still see the craton here in the eastern U.S. As I mentioned, Texas is standing out a little bit special at the southern area south of the southern Oklahoma Lacogen. But what I really want to focus on are these big blue anomalies in the western U.S. where the global models show nothing but big red anomalies. Particularly, we have the Juan de Fuca and Gorda slabs here in the Pacific Northwest. But we also have these other high-velocity anomalies. Particularly, we note, when we look at them in cross-section, we want to ask, what are these guys? What's this guy here? This anomaly through here in the center of Nevada, and this anomaly here in Southern California. So I'm going to take kind of an unusual view through our 3D model. This is a dipping plane. It's at 100 kilometers here in the western U.S. to kind of cut through the Juan de Fuca and the Gorda plates. And then it dips down towards the east to 1,000 kilometers here at the eastern end of our model. Maybe one way to view that is also in 3D. This is from the 3D visualizer built on the Virui software from UC Davis. This is a simple slice in which I have my model box at the surface through the top here, about 1,200 kilometers depth down here at the base. We have the Pacific Ocean along this edge of the model box, and the eastern U.S. at this model box. So you can see that this plane dips from near the surface to the west, much, much deeper into the mantle at the east. And so what I want to draw your attention to is these Silesia Curtain anomaly and Wallawa anomaly, the Nevada anomaly, and the Isabel anomaly. And so we can see these are largely in line with where we may think that there's been slab in the past 30 million years. So I want to ask these questions. So what's the Silesia Curtain? There's been work by Schmant and Humphrey suggesting it's a remnant slab. The Wallawa anomaly by Darrell and Humphreys recently talked about being a continental drip. The Nevada anomaly, which Obrebsky et al. And other authors have suggested is a slab fragment. The West et al. 2009 have suggested it's a lithospheric drip. Or the Isabella anomaly, which has probably the biggest controversy right now, which is where there's a lithospheric delamination. Some earlier models have suggested a drip, and there's some difference we'll get into a little bit later. Where there's also work by Don Forsyth and others suggesting it's possibly a stalled slab. So let's start by looking at the Silesia Curtain. So the curtain here is outlined by the Schmant and Humphreys model as this kind of arcuate curved blue anomaly here in northern Idaho. And when you look at it in cross-section, you see the Cascades showing up very nicely as this nice dipping high-velocity anomaly. And then off to the west, we see the Silesia, this kind of thick, 150-kilometer thick high-velocity anomaly, and then this dripping down curtain like this. And so they looked at this idea of, back at 60 million years ago, this Silesia Curtain anomaly was the leading edge of the Farallon, this kind of indenting into northern Idaho. And as this, back at this time at 60 MA, the Farallon was flat, and so this Silesia plate, part of the Farallon plate, is subducting flat up against the base of the Precambrian North America. At about 50 MA, the flat slab starts to peel away, and the Silesia portion we can see is starting to peel back, and it's initiating the chalice trend magnetism. As this evolves, we start to have more evolution in the plate, and the trench has now retreated to the modern Juan de Fuca. And so they're suggesting that this slab is basically docked into the eastern or into the western edge of North America. So how they came up with this also is this idea that initially the lithosphere was very thin, had not had time to really cool and differentiate to a thick cratonic lithosphere. And based on their model, it's also the temperature contrast consistent with cooling. But there's also been numerical results by Burkett and Gernis suggesting that similar slabs cannot really last in the mantle more than about 10 to 20 million years. And really, they say 10 is about the most, and 20 can require some extreme rheology. So if we go all the way to 60, we have some very significant difficulties with the dynamics of that situation. Now, off to the west of that is the Wallawa anomaly. You can see it's this big blue dot just to the southwest of the Silesia curtain. And when we look at it in cross-section, you can see it's basically this vertical kind of conduit going down to the 410 discontinuity. And I like to discuss this model by Daryl and Humphreys because I think it's very interesting that it's this idea that one of the problems with the Yellowstone plume hypothesis is this idea that there's a lot of these north-south striking dikes in the Columbia River basalts that aren't well explained by a hotspot plume model. So they basically hypothesized that as the plume came out, it found this back end of that Silesia plate, and it started to decouple it. So at this point, we have to kind of ask, is this really oceanic lithosphere that was just sitting at the base of North America, or was it in the process of accreting and becoming North American lithosphere? So I think that's an important question going forward. But one of the main ideas for the being at drip is this bullseye topography, which, at least in this cross-section, is a cartoon. So now for the Nevada anomaly in the center of Nevada. This is from work by the West et al. 2009 paper, in which you can see the large Great Basin drip anomaly. It's this big blue spot in the middle of Nevada. As you look at it in cross-section, either south to north or west to east, it's largely vertical with some bit of a tilt to it, which the tilt, I think, is either due to, I think they explained is basically due to some mantle flow field around it. But really the strong part of their argument was this idea that this high-velocity anomaly is coincident with this swirl in the anisotropy. So you're looking at these various sticks are the shear wave splitting results from SKS splits. And so the direction shows the direction that it implies the direction of mantle flow. And the length of the stick is relative to the strength of the mantle fabric. So they've modeled this basically as this idea that you have this null in the splitting, coincident with the null in the volcanism, no real heat flow signature, but then we have this really strong, basically continuous, high-velocity anomaly from about, looks like their model goes to 100 kilometers down to 800 kilometers depth. So we're suggesting it's a drip due to these low splitting times and a possibly tilted cylindrical shape. The alternative hypothesis proposed by Obrebsky et al., and I think other authors have looked at similar ideas, is that at some point we had to have the Farallon slab subducting. Whether this cartoon is kind of not entirely accurate, since we know the slab was probably flat, not steeply dipping, but the plume was underneath the Yellowstone plume was underneath the Farallon plate. At some point, these would have intersected. And whether it bulged up and there was some weakness within the plate or the pressure from the upwelling helped encourage that weakness, eventually the idea is that at about the time of the eruption of the Yellowstone plume head, the plate was breaking. And as this evolves over time, we start to see the setup of the Yellowstone hotspot track. And what's really driven that interpretation is this 3D view from the DNA09 model, in which you can see the Gorda and the Juan de Fuca plates with a bit of a hole between, and right fitting perfectly in that hole is this F1 anomaly. This F1 anomaly is that same drip and slip, or that same high-velocity anomaly that interpreted by West et al. Now, since the West et al. Paper used the anisotropy as an important constraint, there's another paper I'd like to draw attention to by Yuan and Romanovich, 2010, looking at the depth dependence of the anisotropy. And in this case, they're using both SKS splitting and long-period surface waves to try and constrain the mantle flow field. And I want to draw your attention, even though there's a lot of maps, to the thickest, or to the shallowest and the deepest images. Particularly notable, the basically northeast to southwest anisotropy at 70 versus the northwest-southeast anisotropy in the at the deeper. So when they look at the shallow anisotropy, they make a figure like this B here. So we see anisotropy, which is largely consistent with the uppermost asthenosphere in the western U.S. for its low velocity, and basically NS attribute deeper in the asthenosphere, which is more controlled by the slab to the north and the craton to the east. And when you superimpose these two flow fields, you actually get what's observed, and you're able to get that null right in the center of that Nevada. So we have a whole other way to get that same null in the flow field. Now for the Isabella anomaly, this is a recent work by Jason Salibi and others. And so basically in this, we're looking at the Isabella anomaly and various combination of multiple different methods of seismic imaging in this right set of panels. Basically this, we see the west-east dipping of the high velocity anomaly here from about just below the MOHO. You can see it all the way to 250 kilometers. As we get more towards the center of the anomaly, we can see it becomes a stronger anomaly. It's basically a higher amplitude, high velocity anomaly. And when we look across section, so this last one down here from the northwest to the southeast, largely going through the San Joaquin Great Valley, San Joaquin Basin of the Great Valley, we can see that through most of the Sierra and foothills, we have relatively high velocity lithosphere down to about 100 kilometers. Then as we get to the point of the Tulare Basin and the Isabella anomaly, this high velocity feature dips down to about 225 kilometers or so. So a couple models that have been proposed to explain that is this model by Zan et al. Back in 2004, suggesting this idea of oceanic lithosphere underneath continental lithosphere, starting to build up some of these lower lithosphere big old pile of garnet, and kind of destabilizing it, making it higher density than it otherwise would be. And as the slab, basically this ocean lithosphere goes down the chute, and no new ocean lithosphere comes by to replace it, we basically lose that kind of support for this lower, now dense, lower mantle. And then we start to generate an asthenospheric flow. And as this upwelling counterflow comes up, the drip, the deep, thick pile of granite starts to go down into the mantle, and that's what we're imaging there. The hypothesis proposed by Salibi in that 2012 paper suggests, basically looks at a smaller time scale in which a delamination has already started from the east to the west, and so we can start to see this kind of peeling off of, this is the lower lithosphere, I guess, starting to have this kind of hinge to it. By about 3 million years, this northern part is broken off and is starting to descend into the lower mantle. It's possibly entrained at the younger ages, and as time progresses, we're starting to see south to north progressing delamination through the Sierras. The alternative hypothesis is this idea of, well, the alternative hypothesis stems from looking at these offshore ridge segments. And most notably is this Monterey microplate here, where you can see a small little ridge axis. So we can see some separation and see a small plate starting to generate here. Just based on the offset in the magnetic anomalies. And so when we look at those, the surface wave tomography by Wang et al. 2013, we can see that offshore magnetic anomaly change is very similar, or it's not very similar, but it's offshore right geometrically opposed to the Isabella anomaly. So from this, they've hypothesized that this is the Monterey microplate slab fragment, and in order to get it to stay up in the upper mantle, you have to have relatively negligible buoyancy forces. So how do we differentiate between the two? Well, we can use the topography, or we could look at the anisotropy and the shear wave splitting, and the crustal thickness. So just set up this model from Gagos and Piskulwick is this idea of, well, they're setting up the numerical models for a delamination here and for a drip here. And so for the delamination, you have a slightly denser area, you have a weak zone to decouple, and what's going to happen is that this denser area and this weak zone are going to decouple and they're going to move off in the negative x direction. In the drip scenario, we simply have some thickened dense lithosphere which is going to be inherently unstable. As they run these models forward in time, you can see that basically this delamination model here starts off with this detachment of the denser portion of the continental lithosphere. And you can see how it evolves in time. They have virtually no upper lithosphere, just a tiny sliver of lithosphere left, but largely a lot of deformation to the asthenosphere caused by the traveling of this lithospheric blob. Now they model two different rheologies for the drips, one being a temperature-dependent rheology and a temperature-independent rheology. And you can see that in this case of drip one, you see significantly thickened lithosphere and crust above the drip, whereas this other type of rheology, the temperature-dependent, I think it's temperature-independent rheology, we'll look at it in the next slide, you see markedly thinned lithosphere. So the uplift signal, so this is the topography that we expect as a function of distance along the model. So in each one of these different colored lines shows a different point in model time. So at this t equals 0.13, so very early in the model, we have a little bit of a subsidence. We have a significant subsidence where the dense lithosphere is starting to drop away. And then we get kind of a rebound and some uplift towards the west. As this evolves, we eventually get this stable configuration, which has a significant subsidence off towards the hinge, and significant uplift, and then right at where the thickest lithosphere is, and kind of a decline away from where the anomaly still is. Now, if we have a temperature-dependent rheology for a drip, we see initial subsidence right at the center of the drip, which quickly inverts to the uplift at the center of the drip. And it evolves to this pattern with about a kilometer of uplift. Now, if we have temperature-independent rheology, we get kind of a similar pattern in which there's initial subsidence and then relatively quick uplift. So what does the observed topography actually look like? Well, for the Silesia, we have this topography which leads to long wavelength. It's just gradual increase away from the coast. For the Nevada anomaly, it's probably pretty similar, that we have generally a gradual increase in the topography from west to east. But for the Isabella anomaly, we have something quite a bit different, that we have a major uplift with the Sierra crest and a major major subsidence in the Tulare Basin. Now, this uplift is on the order of 3 kilometers. This is a very, very strong uplift signal. And the thing I'd like to do then is compare, since we've looked at often the alternative hypothesis being this idea of a slab, so let's go ahead and compare these topographic profiles to what we see in the Cascades, where we know there's subduction going on. So in the Southern Cascades, this is a section going through kind of the Gorda section in Northern California. We see, again, this, we have the four, the near coastal, a high topography, and then a gradual increase. In the Central Cascades, we have the foreland uplift, and then the subsidence to the Willamette Valley, and the Cascades volcanic arc. And we see a similar profile in the Northern Cascades through, I believe this goes to the Olympic Peninsula, and then this would be the Puget Sound, obviously very low, and then again the Cascades come up. And so this is actually quite similar, that we have this kind of, in the foreland, we have the uplift, the basin, and then the uplift again, but it's probably the biggest amplitude is actually in the Isabella anomaly, which is starting to argue that this is not really a subduction-generated thing. So to summarize our topographic evidence, the Silesia, there's no real, I would not say in this case there's strong evidence for anomalous uplift. For the Nevada anomaly, the uplift is actually opposite what the delamination model would predict and not at all consistent with what a drip would predict. For the Isabella anomaly, well, yes, it is similar to the Cascades. The relief is quite strong. So now we can start to look at the anisotropy, which was used by West to look at this idea of a drip. And so here's their model that within about 4 million years, we have a very well-developed drip, which drives this flow towards a horizontal null. So all the flow is basically vertical, unless we don't see any radial. So all the flow is radial towards the center of the Earth. and so we don't see any lateral flow around the edges. So we can zoom out a bit, and now I've pulled the Bustervelde database of the shear wave splitting, and you can either get this database from their website, or it's now hosted at IRIS. So I would encourage all authors working on shear wave splitting results to go and send the results to IRIS, and hopefully Andy will talk a little bit more about that at the end of this. We can see this pattern largely of this kind of circular pattern to the center of the U.S. I always have trouble when we see too many splits to look at any type of fine scale structure. So I've gone and made a 2 degree by 2 degree gridding of what these splits are. And so again, we can see this, basically we have this east-west splitting direction through most of the northern western U.S. Significant change to be almost north-south through, say, Nevada and Utah. And we do see this bit of a swirl through Southern California. But if we zoom into these anomalies proper, you're basically looking at the Silesia curtain anomaly. Up here, we don't really see any observations. I'm now overlaying the splits on the stacked DNA 13P anomaly. So this is stacked velocity anomaly from 100 to 400 kilometers depth. And basically, we don't have enough observations where there's a Silesia curtain anomaly. And there's not really strong deflection about the Wallawa anomaly. We do see relatively small anomalies throughout the Nevada anomaly. But as we've looked at the larger scale, that flow pattern is actually a much larger flow pattern than just centered on the Nevada anomaly. Through the Isabella anomaly, there's really no strong deflection that I can see in this pattern. Perhaps other people might see it differently, but that's, you know, the current state. So some of the models to explain the anisotropy, this is a nice model by Zant and Humphreys back in 2008, which is looking at some of these earlier observations of the splitting through the region, and modeling this as a toroid, basically a nice way to look at this is in 3D. So we can see basically as the slab here starts to roll back, the flow of the underlying mantle has to flow around the edge of the slab and back towards it. So we start to generate this toroidal flow. As I brought up the model by Juan and Romanovich earlier, it's also consistent with this idea of toroidal flow around the edge of the slab, but then also guiding by the edge of the craton off to the east. So again, we really have a mantle flow field that's controlled by not necessarily dripping, but by the slab to the north, the craton, slab to the north and the craton to the east. And so the observed null is really a superposition of multiple features. So the other piece of evidence that's often used is this idea of a MOHO hole. So basically a very low amplitude and very low amplitude conversion of PDAS receiver functions. So we look at the simulations from the Gogosk and Diskolwick paper. We can look at the MOHO position as a function of time, or actually it looks like this is just at the fully developed position of the MOHO. So we can see we have relatively thin crust to one side, basically where the material was removed, and thicker crust to where the to the back end, where the basically near the delamination hinge. If we have a drip, basically we have upthrown MOHO on either side of the drip, and a thicker crust right in the center. And that's also consistent with both types of drips, that we have slightly thicker crust along the sides, or thinner crust along the sides, thicker in the center. So when we look at the observations in the Southern Sierra, this is the Zant et al. 2004 paper again, we can see that hole right in the foothills. So we have basically we have a strong conversion under the Sierra Nevada proper, but no real strong conversion right under the foothills. And one of the problems with this observation is that there's not a lot of good data here. You can see this is near the edge of where their model is, and there's a lot of noisy reverberations through a big sediment pile. But anyways, you can model this with some finite different synthetic PRFs. And again, you have basically they're matching this idea of we have a strong conversion where the MOHO is more or less intact, and possibly a deeper conversion, which is much harder to identify. Now, our lovely host, Andy, also had some nice work on this. Here's an example. This is not quite the Isabella anomaly. I believe it's a little bit further north. But I think it illustrates the point nicely that where you have the reset delamination MoHo, so this is the stuff that's already been removed, versus the stuff that's in the process of removing. So the stuff that's been removed, we get relatively thin crust, and where it's in the process of a denser root is starting to, the denser part that's currently in the process of being removed is thickened, and the stuff that's the root that's already gone, again, we have that MoHo hole. However, this is also consistent with observations in a forearc. Here's a 2002 paper by Bostock et al., which in a very clear case of a forearc up in the Cascades, I believe this is about 44.5 degrees north, so through Oregon, basically we have we don't really have a clear MoHo signal here either. So they've hypothesized that this lack of a MoHo is due to a serpentinized mantle forearc. So this idea that as the basaltic ocean crust subducts, it releases water, it ecligitizes the crust. And so this is consistent with experiments by Christensen to look at how low the shear velocity can get as you pump in more percent serpentinite. And so this suggests there's about 50 to 60% serpentinite for these velocities here. So when this happens, you also get a marked drop in the PN velocities. PN velocities, so these are the velocity of the upper mantle, so basically a P wave traveling along the MoHo will propagate at this velocity. And so in the forearc you get about 7.5 to 7.6 kilometers per second, which is also consistent with the PN tomography that was shown by, well, that was done by Heidi Rieg, and it was shown in this Libby et al. Paper. So that's kind of difficult. And if we look at just the MoHo topography, if you will, basically if we look at the Silesia and the Nevada, within error, this is drawn from the EARS database, which is an Earthscope automated receiver functions, we basically see within error a flat MoHo for both Silesia and Nevada. There's one kind of weird outlier for Nevada, but you know, this tightly constrained point is right flat with the rest. But when we look at the Isabella and all three of the Cascades profiles that I showed earlier, we see a patch of thickened crust under or near the lowest topography. But also we note there's not always thickened crust under the high topography. So one other thing to look at is the LAB depth. So this is from a paper by Levander and Miller in 2012. And again, this strontium 706 line comes back into play. And what we note here is that it's really quite shocking how thin much of the lithosphere is here in the western U.S. Normal, globally, continent should be about 140-ish, whereas here we're looking at 80-ish kilometers thick. So we have that very, very thin lithosphere, and it's really, really strong. So there's, at least in my mind, there's three ways that we can really get at this thin lithosphere. It could be the initial state, i.e. this is kind of new lithosphere. It has not had time to grow and differentiate or cool and thicken. Or it could be extension, so maybe it was a bit thicker, but the as it extends, it becomes thin. So we're just think of a simple mass balance here. Or it could be some type of removal, such as the Salibi or Zant hypotheses. So if it's the initial state, then the lithosphere is starting to grow. So we're getting new North American lithosphere, and I think this is the case for the Silesia. If it's extension, then the lithosphere is flowing and redistributing that material. So we have thin lithosphere simply because it's being moved towards the flow and the extension in the basin and range. If it's a removal, then the lithosphere is rapidly being degraded, and I like this term from Dr. Keith Putirka from CSU Fresno, who gave a seminar here at USC the other day. So this idea of being degraded lithosphere, and one of the things that I've always wondered about this idea of lithospheric delamination or lithospheric instabilities is it seems like the models put it at a rate which is very, very fast, order of about 1 to 10 million years to remove a lithosphere. But when you grow lithosphere, the growth models typically are order of tens of millions of years. So it becomes kind of a difficult thing to think about that we have this process that both destroys lithosphere at a much faster rate than it's being created. So what are the blues? Well, I would say the Silesia. I think the best interpretation we have so far is that it's docked oceanic lithosphere. It's in the process of becoming continental lithosphere. The Nevada anomaly, I think we have reasonable evidence that it's a portion of the Farallon. It's now foundering after flat slab subduction has ceased. We don't really see any strong evidence of any type of lithospheric removal there. The Isabella anomaly, kind of wavering, but I think it's kind of a mixture of destabilized North American lithosphere with possible fragments of the Farallon. And I think a big point of this is that the Isabella anomaly has really good evidence for being a lithospheric delamination, but there's also a lot of that, a lot more material than we might expect was there before the delamination started. So, and the question is then, what happened to the plate? Where did the plate go? If all this is removed lithosphere, we should be able to see, we should be able to see the plate deeper. And the volume, total volume of the blue stuff that we see is basically consistent with mostly plate. So with that, I want to thank you for listening. You can have the questions up in the question box or down in the comments. And I want to leave you with this 3D picture that maybe some people like, some don't. But basically, you can see these blues hanging out in the upper mantle. The bottom of this box is at 1,000 kilometers, so you can see the deep source of it coming up and then making its way through the upper mantle like a honey badger moving the blue stuff around it. And you can see this big hole in the Gorda and one of Fuca plates. So, thanks.
All right, great. Well, thank you very much, Rob. So while folks are submitting questions, there are a few in the box. I did want to take the opportunity to quickly plug a couple of the IRIS data products related to some of the things Rob showed in his talk. So Rob, if you don't mind, I'm going to grab the screen back from you for a couple minutes, and then when you're answering questions, you can have control back. So here I go. I'm going to make myself the presenter. Show my screen. Okay, so folks should be able to see my screen. Just really quickly, there were two things that Rob specifically called out, so I thought I would do a plug for those. One is the Earth Model Collaboration Tool. This is a product that is maintained by our data management system team in the Data Management Center office in Seattle, Washington. And it's a great way to move beyond just sort of the traditional stare and compare when you look at models. So on the screen here, you can see the address of it, iris.edu/dms/products/EMC. And if you look at here, you can see just a sampling of the kind of maps that are loaded by this. And so the way it works, so I'm just going to go to this page and do a horizontal slice where you put in, you select from a certain model that you're interested in. So we'll bring up the DNA model since that's something topical to what was discussed today. And then if you click submit, it'll load that on the screen based in sort of a standard GMT projection. And so here you go. So here's the ability to load in real time a model that you want to look at that's already been published. If you want to do more than one, you can actually select more than one model. So here's a case looking at stacked slices where these are different models that you can tune to the same general viewing parameters and then actually make some real comparisons between. You don't have to deal with dealing with somebody's color palette, for example, that might be different from what you use. So that's really all I want to say about that. You can certainly go to the website and play around with this. But one thing we like to always tell people is, please, if you have a model that you'd like to submit to us for this, we use NetCDF format as the intake just to make it as straightforward as possible for accessing. But we're willing to help with folks just to make sure that they have the right tools to submit this stuff. So we want to make this as straightforward as possible. The other thing I want to show is the fact that IRIS indeed does mirror the Geoscience Montpellier's SplitLab shear-wave splitting database. Here's the SplitLab page. I think that references the database through there. Let's see, here we go. Probably clicked on the wrong link. Anyway, I'm not entirely sure whether if you want to submit your SKS results, you should go through the Geosciences Montpellier team, or if you could go through the IRSDMC team. That's probably something that you could, that's documented here. If you contacted Manush, he could tell you the best way to go through this. But it is a great opportunity to account for all of these observations that are routinely generated by research both in sort of from the Earthscope data sets and globally. And I think it's a great opportunity. It's a great resource to be able to tie SKS observations of anisotropy into a talk on sort of broader geodynamics. So again, it's all about getting as much information at reach as we can. So that's all I want to say about that. I'm going to turn it back over to you, Rob, and I have a bunch of questions piled up. So move back over. And I should just say, if anybody has any questions about the last 5 minutes that I've added in here, please feel free to email me or you can ask a separate question.
Okay.
All right. First question was from Rijing He, and tangent on some of the things you were talking about, but Rijing was curious if the numerical models that you had looked at had any relation to the causes of the Yellowstone hotspot.
So in these, in what I presented, at least in kind of the blues, if you will, I didn't really focus on the Yellowstone modeling, though. I know there's been quite a bit of recent work, especially with this idea of colloidal flow and flow off the slab fragments. Let's see, I'm trying to think of the. I can't think of the author right now. But I know there is quite a bit of tank experiments being done. But I'm not sure exactly how applicable those always are. One of the more interesting numerical models, at least in to look at the kind of Obrepsky idea, the one that I like for the Nevada anomaly in particular, there's been a model by Liu and Stegman, which basically doesn't even require the plume to come through the slab so much, but the fact that due to the subduction angles, you can actually have the plate start to break up on its own. And so if the plate breaks up on its own and there's already some upwelling underneath, that'll give that nice pathway to get the Yellowstone volcanics up.
Okay. Next question is from Patrick Taylor. And his question is, what does gravity data show? I guess pertaining to any three of the cases that you were discussing.
The gravity data is not something I've looked at that closely, honestly. Particularly the wavelengths of interest I have not looked at all at. I think that's a really good idea for me to go and start comparing that evidence. I'd be really interested. Kind of one of the best comparisons I can think of right now. There's also unknown high velocities under the Colorado Plateau, which are most often interpreted as drips. And there's some recent work by John McCarthy. I'm not sure exactly. He worked with Rick Astor, doing a joint inversion using gravity, particularly in the Colorado Plateau. And so I think that might give us a really nice way to look at what's going on there. I'm just not familiar enough with that work right now off the top of my head.
I just got a comment from James Nee related to your answer here that he suggests looking at some of the high spatial frequency geoid data just as an add-in. I thought that was worth noting now.
Okay, thanks.
All right, I have a question from Derek Schutt. Derek says, great talk, Rob, and some interesting ideas. I have a question and a comment. Derek's question is, how do you account for the frequency dependence of anelasticity when you combine surface wave and body wave tomography? And
So,
I'll let you answer that first, and I'll bring up the comment afterwards.
okay. So, I'm not sure we talk about the inelastic portion of that. I think that kind of goes to more towards an attenuation type relation. We're really focusing on the travel time. And so, when we do the joint inversion, let me see if I can bring up the building page. When we do the joint inversion, we have these finite frequency kernels. So we've measured the S waves at a band with a peak about 20 seconds. So we're able to do we populate our inversion matrix with that 20-second kernel for the S waves. And then when we go to the surface waves to include that, the surface wave inversion is fundamentally by itself a finite frequency. So we're making a whole set of different periods of observations for the surface waves. And each observation period has its own frequency kernel, or sorry, sensitivity kernel with depth. So we're literally just stacking on the matrix with these body wave delay times, and the matrix with the sensitivity to the body wave delay times, and the matrix with the sensitivity to these finite, or to these variable frequency surface wave observations.
Okay, and then just to tag on, Derek's comment is if you put your splits into a database, your paper will never be referenced, just the database. We need to think of a way as a community to give credit for all the studies used in a compilation.
Agree. Very important.
All right. The next question is from Joelle Wick, and Joelle is asking, in your three dynamical models, what linkages, I'm sorry, wrong question, similar to the Yellowstone plume, do you see a corresponding Vias Caldera plume? And Vias is in New Mexico.
I do see large, there's generally large velocities throughout most of New Mexico, and it seems it's not just restricted to the Rio Grande Rift. The exact depth extent of that, I can't say for sure whether, when we think of a plume, we would think of it basically being a low velocity all the way down into the lower mantle, so down to the base of my model. Unfortunately, I don't have that contoured in this view, but definitely I see low velocities throughout much of New Mexico. I guess here would be a nice way to look at it. This is just looking at the LAB depth. We generally, I guess it's consistent to have thin lithosphere and generally low velocity, but as far as an isolated type, maybe a vertical conduit or a cylinder for the plume, I can't say for sure at this point.
All right, next question is from Will Lewandowski, and Will says, you did a nice job going through these cases by hand, weighing the quantitative evidence somewhat subjectively. Is there a way to automate slash quantify the discrimination among slab drip and accreted slash accreting lithosphere?
So, in the slab drip, I think are we talking about maybe something like this picture? This idea of, I guess, so here's the model of the silicea, and then I guess this is kind of that slab drip, maybe. This idea that it was partially accreted, and now it's starting to make its way into the lower mantle. I think the uncertainties inherent in the final tomography results, right, that smearing and the blob in the ray paths, make any type of automated method very suspect. I mean, I'm generally very suspect in general of anything automated. In particular, when I did the body wave observation, all of those about 300,000 observations that went into the body wave models were all done by hand. So, yeah, I'm not sure exactly how I want to quantify Will's question.
Yeah, one thing Will added was he said, sorry, slab and drip were two different possibilities in his wording.
Okay. So an automated way to tell the difference between a slab and a drip. And I think, that's kind of the point that I'm trying to make here is that a lot of the observations that we commonly make are really consistent with both interpretations. And that's definitely going to be one of the reasons why I think this is so interesting and why it'll be a big debate going forward with Erskine.
All right, next question is from James Nee, and he asks, have you looked at the high velocity anomaly beneath the Western Colorado Plateau to Western Rocky Mountains? This feature is down to about 200 kilometers, and there is a quote unquote Moho hole beneath the Western Colorado Plateau in the vicinity of the Colorado River. Could it be related to lithospheric instability?
Yes, it's right here. I'm highlighting it with my mouse. And my favorite piece of evidence for this instability comes from, again, one of Alan Mavander's papers. I forget exactly who was the first author, but it was maybe Kaijin Liu. And he looked at basically, it was a P receiver function type image in which they not only showed the hole in the crust, but they saw that conversion at greater depth. So it was something that you could, in Illustrator, very quickly just cut out the high velocity anomaly and place it right in the missing hole. And when you see that type of example, it's really strong. But the exact topographic signal that we expect from that, I don't know how much I've seen yet on that work. One of the things that I found quite interesting at GSA that kind of speaks to this point is that I guess that anomaly that James is talking about was kind of right in here. But there's been also some recent work, some recent flexible array experiments looking here in the southern Rocky Mountains and up in the Powder River Basin. And the interesting thing is that a lot of the observations that are coming out of the early stages of those experiments are also consistent with many of the delamination or instability models. But the authors so far have argued for other sources of uplift, or uplift being the big issue since we have these high topography, but it's not really supported by a thick crustal root. So whether that be some type of the other, I always forget between Pratt and Airy isostasy, but the isostasy that basically we have density variations rather than a thick root. So coming back, I guess that's kind of a long-winded way to get around that Colorado Plateau question. But yes, I think there's good evidence for that being the drip, especially I think Kaijin's paper talks about that nicely.
All right, the next question is from Jonathan Delph, and Jonathan's asking, lithosphere delamination is becoming prevalent in the literature, and it seems that it is becoming the scapegoat for uplift that is not isostatically compensated for. Do you think we need to rethink formation and subsequent removal of mantle lithosphere in younger, more active regions?
I completely agree with that point, and that's one of the reasons why I'm thinking so much about this question, is that it is kind of, sometimes we get to this point where we see an anomaly, we don't really know what it is, so we appeal to the delamination mechanism. And in some cases it is pretty strong, and other cases not so strong. But I think kind of our job to kind of talk high and mighty, our job as scientists is, to try and prove the hypothesis wrong. It might not be. And if it's not wrong and we try to prove it wrong, then that's kind of why we're doing this whole science game. The more we beat that hypothesis, hopefully it'll either go away or it'll be strong, and then we will start to rethinking about this process of continental evolution. There is work at AGU that kind of struck me. I forget who exactly it was working with Sinti Lee and suggesting this new model of continental growth through continental instability. So as these denser roots start to go away, they're replaced by less dense roots. So we're starting to generate stable cratons through the process of delamination.
So I have a question slash comment. I've never really had an excuse to do this, but one of my figures was actually shown in here. So I just had an interesting observation on this. So in these three case studies, what I think is neat is that the scales of these anomalies that are being discussed are very different. On the scale of these cross sections, where we're looking at the Moho hole slash the sort of muted Moho, it's only 50 kilometers across, and something like the Nevada anomaly is probably a couple hundred kilometers in terms of the tomography. So it's interesting that this may or may not be the same process at work at different stages, but it's certainly there's certainly different scales of these anomalies that you're looking at here. And the one thing that I did want to point out on this cross section is that this was the original SNEP receiver functions that were done, and the two things that point taken on the 2004 cross sections, that it's hard to get data out of the Great Valley because it's a reverberating pile of sediments, and it's hard to do good imaging off of that. The one thing that we were particularly careful about this go around, and then in subsequent work that hasn't been published yet, is really trying to dial up the imaging as accurately as possible. And what we're seeing is that there is a detectable MOHO interface that you can pull out of the data, and it's surprisingly deep still, even in areas in the lower foothills in the sort of 55 kilometer range, and you can clearly see it dip down into that zone. So it gives us a lot of a pretty good feeling that it's a real interface. So it's just it's an it's the SNEP area in particular. I still think that we haven't figured it out completely because it's such a locally interesting area. I could go on for this for probably 20 minutes, so I won't. But it's cool to see this, it's cool to see this approach to that data set.
Yeah, and I think the scales point that you brought up right at the beginning is really, really important. That kind of why I kind of hand wavy at the end said maybe it's a mixture of slab and continental lithosphere. But when we look at the size of some of these anomalies, it becomes very difficult to reconcile large scale removal of the lithosphere with the size of these very, very large blue anomalies. And to that point, we first need to find out where is the Farallon? Is it all just a big slab wall as Siglock has proposed? Did it all go down the chute and we can't really see it? Kind of the point that I want to start with is, which I didn't really make too clearly today, but is where is the slab? That's the first question we need to ask.
Yep, agreed. So related to California, Sampath Rathnayake is asking, do you have any idea about the crustal and lithospheric thickness in Southern California, particularly the borderlands and edge of the ocean in that region?
It's extremely thin. As I mean, we have the lithosphere. This paper by Levander and Miller does not do the best job, particularly in Southern California. I would reference you to a paper, I think either 2011 or 2013, by Ved Lekic, working with Carr and Fisher. And again, they were doing, I think, P to S. I'm pretty sure they were doing S to P receiver functions, but probably also P to S and surface waves, particularly focusing in that area. The other type of work you might want to start looking at is work by Rob Clayton and Fanchi Lin. And I think Brandon Schmatt worked on some of this as well, that there is the Long Beach Array, which is a tiny little array down in Southern California, but amazing, tiny little array in terms of lateral size, like 5 by 7 kilometers. But 5,000 sensors there. So that's something you might want to look into to learn more about what's going on there. Also, the Salton Sea Imaging Project, which there's a lot of results starting to come out from there. So I'd start to look into the work by those groups. But I can't give you like 8 kilometers off the top of my head or something like that.
You can also add Ryan Porter's paper. He looked at receiver functions in Southern Cal not only for crustal thickness, but also like anisotropy stuff. I think that was published maybe a year or two ago. All right, so just a couple questions left. Another one from Joel Wick, who is asking, do you observe any relationship of the anomalies to post-glacial rebound boundaries, i.e. flexure of the lithosphere?
That's an interesting idea that I have not looked at. Yeesh. Yeah, I would need to look at basically the post-glacial rebound map first, and I haven't really had a chance to look at that. So I guess she asked, have I looked? The answer is no.
All right, and last question, back to James Nee. He is curious, so back to that drip in the plateau, potential drip. Do you know how this would have started? Is it possible that it's an edge-driven convection effect?
I think edge-driven is the main, is the typical hypothesis, and I have no reason to suspect otherwise at this point. Though I do have, when I came started to look at this question, I do have a bias towards thinking that cratonic lithosphere is strong and lasts. So processes that can start to destroy it would be very interesting. And I think you would need either some very, very weak lithosphere in the Colorado Plateau in order to allow that mechanism to work, or very vigorous upwelling. And I think I'm going to leave that question to the modelers who can do a better job at looking at the forces that would be exerted on the side of the drip, or the side of the lithosphere in that scenario.
All right. So have another question that just came in, and this is from Ayub Kaini. Two questions, two-part question. One, how do you validate your models mainly for the deeper parts of the model?
So the main validation method that we've used, so there is checkerboard tests which do show that we get bigger, I guess I didn't present them, but the checkerboard tests do show that we get more streaking at greater depths, so we have to look at bigger or larger scale anomalies at greater depth. But the validation approach, I think there's a lot of work that can be done in the realm of validation, and I'm working on, well, actually, in the paper that you can find at dna.berkeley.edu, there, we do have a little validation approach that's kind of that after reviews got squirreled into the supplements. But basically, I think it's a cool idea that I took the model and I measured how well we recover the input data, and it's something like, it's pretty close. It's something like 80% or higher accuracy. Forget exactly right now off the top of my head, but we did a pretty good job recovering the input. And then we also did something where we tested data for events that were not included in the model. So let's say we had about, I think, 300 events that went into this DNA model. We picked 10 random events that were of the same size and distance, and we picked their delay times, and we compared those pick times to what we would expect if the rays were to travel through our model, and they come out to be extremely close, again, on the order of 90% accuracy. So that kind of gives me confidence that the model is recovering the it's at least recovering the delay time. But again, that's only one part of the delay time's only one part of the seismic wave train. So there's more that can be done, and I think that's a very important direction to start going as we look at more of these models coming out.
All right, and the second part of Ayub's question was, it seems to me that your tomography models show p-velocity structure. What do you expect about the s-velocity structure that is somehow more related to thermal anomalies in the mantle?
So again, I'll reference you to this same website that we have actually four different models. So for this question, I focused on the P model because it was kind of the first one out of the chute. But we do also have SH, SV, and SV joint model. But the reason why I kind of stuck to this, the P model, is that the structures don't really change that strongly when we go to the S models. So, you know, I could have just as easily made these profiles through our SH model or our SV or our SV joint model. But as I talked about in the pros and cons, you know, the actual amplitude is somewhat constrained by the regularization in the solution. So I'm always very careful about interpreting amplitudes and try to stick more to the relative blues and reds than the actual amplitude.
All right. Well, that was our last question. Rob, thank you very much. I feel like I'm obligated to clap because you did such a great job. So even though we can't do complete applause for you, that was an awesome webinar. Very thoughtful. We really appreciated it. And to everyone else out there, thank you for coming. Next webinar is going to be in 2 weeks, and our speaker is going to be Stephen Hicks, talking about the 2010 Maule 8.8 earthquake in Chile and some of the data that was collected subsequent to that from the Rapid Array Mobilization Program. So I think with that, we'll adjourn. Rob, thanks again. Have a great rest of the day, everybody, and we'll see you all back here in 2 weeks.
Thanks.
Yep.